Welcome to the Mavens of Marketing, a weekly podcast hosted by me, Rachel Durkin.
And me, Kerry Barrett. We talk all things marketing, innovation, sales, and business growth strategies, and the standard tried and true marketing techniques.
Come for the conversation, stay for the savvy insights.
And the borderline inappropriate jokes. Welcome, party people, to the Mavens of Marketing. We're glad that you could join us for another episode. I'm Kerry Barrett, joined by co-creator and co-host Rachel Durkin. How are you, my doll?
Everyone.
We were just talking about how our parenting styles have changed a little bit since the dawn of the pandemic, where we used to be very strict about like, oh, no TV until you're two, and then only 30 minutes a day. And now you were saying, you're like, if you watch Toy Story 1 through 4 all in a row, I'll give you a bag of Oreos.
That's basically my new parenting style. And then in between, I'm going to put Mickey Mouse ABC Mouse on and be like, here's your education for the day. Now go back to Toy Story.
Listen, as long as you're not playing at the top of the stairs with Tide Pods and scissors, I'm fine.
Well, I'm okay with the top of the stairs. The Tide Pods, maybe. The scissors is my hard no, unless they're the kids' scissors.
You have standards.
I do have standards. They're going down astronomically fast, but they're there.
We're tracking them, and that's really what's important. We're pulling the analytics.
Exactly.
And speaking of analytics, we have a fabulous guest here today. KP, it's good to have you with us.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
How are your kids? Because you have two little ones too.
Yeah, I have 2, 5, and 8 years old. YouTube is their new mommy.
Yeah.
And next year they'll be playing with fire and doing whatever they want. They will be like,
Wait, so how come your wife has taken the blame? Well, maybe YouTube's their new daddy.
I'm on your podcast, so she's not around. So.
KP's already digging his hole. Like, yeah. Let's start this off the right way.
Well, we are thrilled to have you join us. And just to give our audience a little bit of the background, KP is a fabulous strategist, and I'll let him introduce himself and tell you what he does in a moment. But we do a lot of work together with joint clients in terms of video strategy and use and competitor research when it comes to what your competition, immediate competition, what your immediate competition is doing, and then also what your perhaps aspirational competition is doing. And it's really interesting to take a look at. So with that said, KP, why don't you tell our audience all about you and what you do?
Sure. So I own and run Board Studios. It's a video strategy agency, like you said. We think that video is the future. And video is very problematic. It has to be used very strategically. And that's a big issue we saw with many clients. We've learned a lot by working with clients over the last 10 years. And we've come up with a framework where we use what works for others successfully to help our clients leapfrog the competition, jumpstart their growth, and not waste too much time and money testing useless things. Because I've tested them myself, I failed. And through that failure, I've learned a lot.
See, that's it. It's not a failure. It's just I've learned what doesn't work.
It costs a lot of money.
That's true. And time. So when you look back on it, it's a little depressing, but it was a very good lesson. Let me ask you something. So when I hear you say that, my belief in marketing is you put it into 3 core pillars, and I'm really generalizing here, or buckets, so to speak. One is your target audience, knowing them like the back of your hand, what they want, what they need, their pains, what's good for them, even if they don't think it's good for them. And then messaging, how do you go to market? How do you position something so it's compelling and resonating to that audience? And then go to market, your social outlets, your email marketing, your mediums to get there. What I hear you talking about is this concept of content that's compelling. It falls into that messaging bucket. So talk to me a little bit about what makes it, there's so much content out there, and there's the argument that just do content, just get started, just put something out there, which has some legs to stand on, but what makes it compelling and impactful? Like what have you learned from all these failures, so to speak?
Well, that's down to brass tacks.
Yeah, that's all of ours right there. I was thinking what I've learned, but it boils down to commoditization and decommoditizing yourself. And that has to do with both the targeting and the messaging, like you said. And the tactics that we have learned address both. So where I failed, I've tried all the fads, cold calling, cold emailing, SEM agency, growth hackers, sales gurus, business coaches. I've tried it everything and nothing worked. I mean, zero sales, which is amazing. Like you would think by luck, you would close somebody.
Right. So maybe it's you. I'm just teasing.
Well, Kerry, you're not supposed to insult the guests on the podcast.
He knows I love him. I'm teasing. Go ahead.
So I hired somebody else to do the selling and I hired a coach for them. So I tried that as well. I A/B tested myself.
So you removed yourself.
It might be me.
Yes. I thought about for the longest time and maybe it still is, but I don't think that now.
No.
So instead of, so everybody says I have to learn how to sell, which is targeting, marketing message, everything. And they start testing because they hear, oh, LinkedIn outreach works, or, oh, blogging, I have to create a blog, or I have to start a YouTube channel, or I have to put content out there.
Yeah.
And to me, because I've tried that, I think it's the biggest mistake because it's not gonna work. You're gonna waste time and money. So how do you figure out what works is look at the companies that do it successfully in your industry. Go and see Inc. 5000, my industry, who is succeeding, who is growing very fast. And then see what they're doing. There are tools out there that help you spy on them, spy on what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And we call that the no more guesswork, to remove the guesswork out of your growth. Look at the successful companies, spy on them, see what they do, and then copy it.
I call that legal stalking.
Yeah.
And I do it regularly.
What is this? This is the no more guesswork framework that you sort of put together after you experienced some failures. And then after you interviewed other or spoke with and spied on, and I want to ask you about that in a moment, other companies in your industry who were succeeding. And then you put this framework together. So can you, without giving away everything, can you sort of walk us through what that looks like?
And I can give away everything. It doesn't matter. I'd love to. So it boils down to three things. It's one is first of all, you have to figure out who are the big competitors, the successful companies. And there are many tools out there. You can look at the conferences who is presenting, look at the Inc. 5000, look at Owler. There are many ways to do that. Once you find a list of 5-10 companies, then you have to see what works for them. So you have to do content marketing, paid advertising, and then thought leadership. These are the three that I have boiled it down to. There are probably other tactics as well.
I'm sorry, say that again. You said content marketing.
So it's organic traffic, content marketing, paid traffic, so paid acquisition funnels, PPC, and thought leadership, which could be summits, podcasts.
Mm-hmm.
And
sure.
And there are many other things, but I actually had a podcast where I interviewed these companies because I wanted to find out what actually works. So I interviewed these people and they were telling me these things repeatedly. So I boiled it down to these three things. There are many other tactics. I'm focusing on these three because I've heard that they work. And then it's how do you copy from the competitors? So look at the competitors, which one works? So of these three strategies, don't do all three of them. Start by seeing what is the low hanging fruit?
Mm-hmm.
So it could be, there are tools that show you how companies get organic traffic. You enter the URL, it shows you, these are the pages, they send this much traffic. Then you do keyword analysis, you see who's ranking higher, how much volume they're getting. So if you see that companies in your field who are successful are doing a lot of content, they have a blog and they're getting a lot of volume, start doing that. But don't do it haphazardly where you say, oh, now I have to come up with all these content ideas. Yeah. See what works, see what drives traffic for them, and then copy it. And how do you copy it? You make it your own. And then how do you make it better? You make it with video. So with everything that we do, video ties in very nicely because it is the future. And it does help you amplify your message. If you say my competitor who is very highly ranked has XYZ blog post and it works really well, if you post the same blog post, it's not gonna rank very well because you're not as powerful of a website. So, but if you do a video, the competition there is much lower and you get SEO boost by having a video on your website because you engage more. So doing video with a similar blog post can help you leapfrog the competition.
So let me ask you a question. So I have this belief in marketing. And I think we're in agreement in some areas and in some, I just want to follow up on, have you ever heard of the painting of a style called pointillism? Okay. So for those of you who are listening who don't know it, Google pointillism, but there are some really famous paintings where there are these beautiful works of art and they were made entirely by dots. You know, millions and millions and millions of dots create this amazing painting. That to me is what marketing is. Millions of dots, millions of actions, millions of go-to-market plans, a tweet, a Facebook post, a video, a salesperson having a conversation. And when they're put together, they create a masterpiece. But doing just one thing, if you just do one video, you're probably not going to get anywhere. And we're talking about ROI here, right? And so in my world, ROI or metrics are measured, success is measured by building brand assets and brand growth, and then direct ROI to the sales funnel. And what I'm hearing you say is start with a competitive analysis. So look at what the other guys are doing. We don't want to use the word copy, but how are they going to market? How can you differentiate yourself slightly, but still follow the path that they've forged towards success? And then adjusting it slightly, using video to give yourself an upper hand. Is that what I'm hearing?
Pretty much, yes. Okay. So find the competitors, figure out what strategies work. Maybe it's content, maybe it's paid ad funnels, maybe leadership. Decide on which one you want to focus on. Execute by using video in order to amplify it. So
my only pushback would be, I think that, and it depends on where in the phase you are in your marketing journey. Most people listening to this call are a little bit more experienced, like they're CMOs or they've done marketing. I would argue that you really should be doing all of those things at once as you can grow into it.
If you have the resources, absolutely.
If you have, of course, it always comes down to resources.
It's just a few of our clients who are in the small, medium-sized businesses, they don't have the resources or it's overwhelming. Like, you're already doing all these things. Your team is tied up with a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And now you have to do all this stuff.
So you mentioned data. Tell me a little bit about the data of video. I mean, in my experience, you can get so much more good information from how long someone watches a video, where they drop off the video, what the views are, what the clicks are, because you're literally watching their behaviors as they're interacting with you. So tell me a little bit more about video and data and how you use that to help your clients be successful.
So with video, data is very important because it can show you exactly what you're saying. If you're advertising, you can see how effective your ad is because you can see what percentage of the ad was viewed, then what you have, if they visited your website, and you can even track conversions. So it can be a very good part of a funnel. It can also be very good for SEO, where you can track in the Google Analytics or any other platform you're using to track your visitors on your website. You can see where they're going. So there are data platforms that show you heat maps of your website where you see where they're scrolling, where they're staying a little longer. And usually video is where the heat map will be more dense. So people will spend a lot more time watching video. And on average, I think they're finding that if your average visitor is spending 30 seconds on your website, adding a video may add 1 minute, which has a big impact in terms of lowering your bounce rate, engaging them. And when you engage them with one thing, they will engage with another thing. The challenge is when you have, even if you have the greatest messaging and your website is beautiful, people now, they just scroll really fast, they consume it on mobile, they don't engage with it, they get a first impression. If you have a video, it's much more likely they will click on it, watch it, you will track how much they watched, you will see how much time more they're spending on your website, which is a huge benefit for SEO and bounce rate, and you can track all these things. So the video ROI can be proven, but it does take more time unless you're using it for conversions or ads. If you're using it for SEO, it may take a little longer to improve.
When you talk about, you know, how quickly people are scrolling through, and I may be getting a little bit granular, but I know that, you know, different platforms play video in different ways. Some you have to click on, some scroll automatically, some have audio, some have to tell you to turn the sound on. How should you differentiate the types of videos that you use, or maybe the thumbnails that you use, or the way that you use them based on the different platforms?
Well, based on your intended use and what you want to accomplish, you should absolutely differentiate the videos. Should it be 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 2 minutes? It really depends on where the user is on the funnel, where you use it on your website. So a video that you put at the front page above the fold. And when you have a video, like we create some videos and they say, oh, let's put it on the About Us page. No, you have to put it above the fold. You have to put it front and center. It's your biggest asset where people will engage and actually understand what you do. When they read your tagline, they're not going to understand what you do. It's just to intrigue them so they will watch the video. Then they understand what you do. Then they will engage with everything. Then maybe they will go to About Us. So the biggest mistake is hiding your video. You have to put it front and center, and you have to make sure that you're using it the right way. If you're using an email campaign, you will use a different video, different length, different content versus if it's top of the, you know, above the fold on your website versus if you're playing it in a conference or if you're using it for an ad.
So talk to me for a second about, there's so much video content out there now, right? And we were actually on one of our recent podcasts, we were talking about how the whole world, the digital world is very noisy with video, but it's still, I'm not arguing that it's compelling and one of the top ways to engage an audience. However, you've got to differentiate, right? So we mentioned that earlier in this podcast. Can you share one or two ways that, you know, to kind of like key takeaways that the audience can do to make their content better than the other guys?
Yeah, and it goes back to, I had interviewed somebody who said about commoditization, decommoditization, and it's super important. Mm-hmm. Video can help you decommoditize yourself. Right now, because there is so much content, so much noise, it's very easy for your client to perceive you the same way as everyone else. They mm-hmm. don't have differentiation. In your mind, you're very different, but in your client's mind, everybody's the same. What video does is that slowly it can engage and it gives you the license to explain how you're different. If you do a blog post, you may be accomplishing the same thing, but it's much more difficult. If you're doing a series of videos where you engage and you have to start with a funnel approach where you say, these are awareness videos, these are mid funnel, these are bottom funnel. That's how you can explain your differentiation, establish yourself as a thought leader, and then they want to work with you. But to differentiate yourself, the biggest thing is you have to have a strategy behind video, because I've worked mm-hmm. with many people who come and say, for example, we want to be thought leaders. We're starting this summit. We're going to be posting a video a day. Okay, but what is your what is your goal with the summit? If it's to generate ticket sales, it's very different. If it's thought mm-hmm. leadership for LinkedIn, very different mm-hmm. in terms of the content you'll be putting out there, but also the format. Mm-hmm. And the biggest mistake is they do thought leadership pieces that are half hour, 1 hour long, and they post it on YouTube and they get 20 views. Nobody will engage with a 30 to 60 minute video. You have to do clips. You have to have the right messaging. You have to SEO optimize it. You have to pay promote it. And the good thing with YouTube is that you can pay promote things very cheaply and with very good targeting, both geographically and thematically.
So Kerry, we talked recently, I don't remember when, about ways to create engaging videos. And you mentioned a couple different emotions that you can kind of inflict. So can you talk about that a second?
Absolutely. So, you know, it's interesting. One of the things that people often forget about in video, and KP, you can tell me if you sometimes struggled with this particular element with some of your clients, don't name names, but it's that.
Or name them.
Yeah, but
we always like a good scandal.
Yeah. Actually, go ahead. the thing about video is that I draw on this knowledge from my time in the TV world, being on camera. It doesn't matter really. I mean, it matters what your message is, but if you can't deliver it in a way that makes people want to watch, meaning you're either boring, you're unlikable, you're not compelling. If you're any one of those things, it doesn't matter. You could almost be telling somebody what the next winning lottery ticket is, and you're going to struggle to get them to listen. That may be a slight exaggeration, but you get my point. One of the ways to make yourself, and it's hard to, you know, I can't give you a personality, but one of the things to keep in mind.
She's not talking right to you, KP. She's talking to in general.
She is.
Rachel.
It probably is to me. My videos never do quite as well as Kerry's do. So.
No, but one of the things to keep in mind as you're planning out what you're going to say is that emotions are what sit with people longer mm-hmm. than data and statistics. And the data and statistics are important. Those things are the things that will make you think, but it's the emotions and sort of the storytelling that often doesn't often, that stays with people for a longer period of time. So what are those emotions that people are connecting with, especially now? Rachel, you mentioned nostalgia. That's a huge one. We mm-hmm. want to go back to a simpler time, for better or for worse. Certainly anger and outrage are, listen, all you have to do is take
politics.
Take 10 seconds on Twitter. You'll get your fill of anger and outrage for the decade. And then humor and inspiration. And I find right now, one of the ways to cut through a lot of the digital noise. And this is sort of the goal of this podcast. You know, we want it to be super informative, but we also want it to put a smile on people's faces as they listen, because we need that, especially now. And so if you can find a way to structure your content that elicits inspiration, you know, assuming, you know, all things being equal and those, these emotions are appropriate to what it is that you're talking about, inspiration or humor are great ways to get people to engage with your video. If I always say that if you can get somebody to naturally smile as they're listening to what you're saying, you've already won. You've taken them into a spot that they like you. And that is sometimes the biggest hurdle of all. So I don't know if you found some of that, those similar elements with your clients, KP, and how that affects the strategy that you use or the messaging that you put around certain types of videos.
I think it's very similar to what you're saying. What you're saying is the ideal.
Yeah.
With our clients, we have a lot of restrictions, limitations we have to deal with. Usually we would interview the people at the client and see who has more.
Who is the best one for camera? The rest of you suck. I'm only going to talk to you.
Is there anybody that has three heads? Okay, you're out.
Yeah. Actually, I think they should be in. You and I are thinking about this very differently.
That is actually super important. Finding the most charismatic person in a company and highlighting them as the spokesperson can make a huge difference. Mm-hmm. Strategy number one, because whatever you do next, if it doesn't deliver on the strategy, it doesn't matter. Like people are, I spoke yesterday with somebody, super charismatic, doing an amazing conference. It's not accomplishing anything. His goals are here and what he's doing there. So it doesn't matter what he does, but he's super charismatic. So he has a leg up. If you're not, then you have to partner with somebody who's charismatic. So I'm not charismatic. I'm partnering with people who will make others listen to the message. Because they won't listen to me.
We're listening to you. Don't tell our audience to leave. My God, no wonder.
He's like, this is useless. Just go away. Right. You're like Eeyore from Winnie the Pooh. There's no point in life. Where's your tail? We believe in you, KP. So let me ask you something, KP. What is this? You know, you talked about these big companies and then kind of, as I call legally stalking them. What is this big secret behind the success that they have with their video content?
So it depends by industry. I would look at specific industries and see what they're doing. If they're doing content, you will see they're using content everywhere and they're using it very strategically and they're leveraging the power of video. Meaning if they do a blog post, you will see it has a video, or they will do the video first and then repurpose it into a blog post. You will see it on YouTube, you will see it on LinkedIn. They use all the tactics in terms of the right thumbnails, SEO optimized titles, descriptions that are SEO optimized. They have the subtitles. They have a launch team. So when you put something on YouTube, it's not I put it there and it will grow like the weed. It's you have to prime the pump, especially if you're a new channel. You have to tell people, go search for my keywords, go watch the video, like it, share it, comment, and then watch more videos. So YouTube rewards you for your watch time for your channel. And that's how you grow. And then organically will show your videos to others because they think, this person has interesting content, let's test it out. And they will spread it out after 6 months, approximately, they will start showing your videos organically to a bigger audience. And if you have the right thumbnails and keywords, you will get a high click through and then they will start showing you more and more.
And one thing that I think is so important is that when you're doing content, a lot of us, especially in like the service industry, are doing it with I think when you're thinking small, you're doing it with an end in mind. How is this one tiny piece of content, this 1 minute video, going to get me to a sale? And if you're thinking that way, you are never going to win. I think it's creating the content is about creating things that are compelling to your audience as they're listening to it, to going back to that pointillism painting, adding a dot. And using those dots to drive them through the sales funnel, which requires another strategy that, you know, I don't know that we'll have time to talk about today, but I think it's about focusing on the content in that moment and not about the sale. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. In fact, I've interviewed people who have said it better than me, and they say you have to forget about revenue. Hold on to revenue. As an owner of a business, it's very difficult, but that's what you have to do.
Nobody ever wants to hear that.
I know, but that's not popular. About revenue. If you make content because you think it will generate sales, just stop, because it's not going to work. And when you stop worrying about that, it will work beautifully. That's It's very counterintuitive, but it's
aligned. Yeah, I want to ask you one other question. And Rachel, I didn't mean to cut you off, but when you talk about counterintuitive and like the purposes of creating content and how to get people to watch, and when we were on a call with a client, you and I, KP, about a month ago, you mentioned a tactic that for many people may seem counterintuitive, but when you look at why you're using this tactic, it makes a lot of sense. And you talked about, right, you could go into these certain platforms, SpyFu is one of them, see what keywords are ranking for your competitors and your aspirational models and all those other sorts of things. But to actually engage in a video with somebody who's in your space who has a larger market. So for example, let's say you owned a small salon and you wanted to latch on to the following that, say, a Paul Mitchell has. And this is, in fact, the exact example that we looked at. Trying to do some sort of video collaboration with a large brand who is an aspirational competitor gives you exposure to their audience as well. And so while it sounds superficially like, why the heck would I go talk to someone who's doing better than I am in my own space? It gives you an introduction to a huge audience that you may not otherwise get, or that may take you years to establish.
Yeah, using direct competitors. It's actually, years back, there were some articles about how you can boost your blog, and it was creating a list of your competitors, the big competitors, but including yourself in the list. And those work really well because Google, there's a halo effect. And if they see you associated with Paul Mitchell, they're like, okay, so I know they're a salon, I know they're successful, I know they're doing XYZ, they boost your rankings. Same thing works with consumers. Mm-hmm. If they see you in the same list as Paul Mitchell, they say, okay, this is a pretty good company.
Yes.
Well, it's counterintuitive because you're promoting them, but do you really care if you lose some clients to Paul Mitchell? You would have lost them anyway, probably.
Right.
Well, there's also the challenge of convincing Paul Mitchell that they should do a video with you.
Yeah.
I also, I find
that's when the charisma comes in.
That's right. You got to really try. I also find though, and I think that's a really interesting point, that finding a competitor who's not exactly a competitor, maybe they're an overlap competitor. Yeah. You have a better chance of a sale there because there is a win-win opportunity. So that's also something to consider is maybe not go head to head, but you know, just a little bit of an overlap.
Yeah.
KP, let me ask you, the world is changing really fast right now. Video is on the rise because of our new virtual environment that we're all stuck in. We've done a different episode recently about how video might actually go down a little bit as people start traveling again, and we might switch over to podcasts or more listening. Tell me a little bit about what you think the future of video looks like.
And can I address, because you said that it's difficult to get Paul Mitchell, can I address that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
There is a strategy to, and we're working on it right now with a couple of clients. Their biggest challenge is we have this awesome product, but we don't have the strong brand. So people see us as a commodity and they go after price, and we're going to lose.
Mm-hmm.
So to elevate your brand, you have to associate yourself with the Paul Mitchells of your industry. But how do you do that? Why do they care? And that's where virtual summits come in. Mm-hmm. Now, if I, and I'm doing the virtual summit, so for the client, if I do a virtual summit and I say, hey, let's do a summit together with Paul Mitchell will say no. But what if I go to five of them and say, Paul Mitchell and your competitor and the other person and the other person, I'm inviting you, and then I'm associating myself with the other brands, and they lend me credibility to convince all of them to come with me.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we have a summit, I have that halo effect for my brand. I elevated my brand, and I have amazing content, and I have relationships, and I can tap into their audience. Because guess what? I'll do the summit, then I will share it in clips on YouTube and LinkedIn. I will tag them. Their audience will see me, and they will see I'm associated and affiliated with Paul Mitchell. And that's just by a virtual summit, which is not very easy, but it's easy to execute. It's the best strategy to connect with much bigger companies, more successful companies, and also to connect with potential high value clients, because you can interview them and you say, I have Paul Mitchell. Now, when I interview one of your big vendors, they are very likely to say yes. They don't even know me. If I was doing a podcast, come to my podcast, they might say no.
Mm-hmm. Unless I
had Paul Mitchell on the podcast. A summit is the prelude to a successful podcast for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because you bring all these companies together and then you can leverage them to get bigger companies on a podcast basis. So it's a continued content marketing approach that's thought leadership, a little different than the blog posting and the SEO optimization, But for the thought leadership, I have found this to work really well.
That reminds me of a joke that I'm trying to look up because I'm not going to do it right if I tell you it now, but about like management and telling others that others are involved when they're not quite involved yet. But it's true. I wish I could find that joke. Anyway, go on.
We create a summit page with the 10 speakers that we want. It's a draft. And we tell them the page, are you in? And when they see the other names, they're like, they assume that the other people are in. And some of them are.
You're giving away your secret here on your bait and switch, though. You better be careful.
It's not exactly a bait and switch because we do bring them on. So it works.
It's not a bait and switch as long as it works.
Exactly. But it doesn't, because people want that connection, especially right now. Don't go to all these conferences. And you won't go to the Paul Mitchell, to the CEO. You will go to the marketing VP. And to them, they haven't presented. You know, you put the spotlight on them, you make them a thought leader. They're going to like it, especially if we do a good job with the videos, the editing. They will share it. They will like it.
Yeah.
So it propagates the message very well.
So going back to the future video question.
Yes,
I found the joke. Can I tell you it?
No, yes. Maybe
no. All right. So a father says to his son, I want you to marry a girl of my choice. And the son says, I'll choose my own bride. And the father says, but the girl is Bill Gates' daughter. And the son answers, well, in that case, yeah, okay, I'll marry her. And then the father approaches Bill Gates and says, I have a husband for your daughter. And Bill Gates says, but my daughter's too young to get married. And the father says, but the young man is a vice president of the World Bank. And Bill Gates says, okay, in that case, he can marry my daughter. And then finally, the father goes to the president of the World Bank and says, I have a young man to recommend as a vice president. And the president says, but I already have a vice president. And the father says, but this young man is Bill Gates' son-in-law. And the president says, if that's the case, then okay. Yeah. And that's kind of like...
Yeah.
Well done. That was worth the wait.
Tied it all together.
Yes.
And that joke was partly in French, and I read the subtitles very well just now. Anyway, go ahead, Kerry.
Or KP. Future.
Or I thought you were Kerry. Okay, weren't you about to ask a question?
Oh, I was. Tell us about the future video.
Okay. There you go.
From my perspective, I think companies. I work primarily with service companies, B2B space. So they're the slowest to adopt video, but a lot of them are getting exposed to it. So they understand the power of video. And the challenge is that video is very complicated and expensive. It's a pain. There are so many hurdles.
Mm-hmm.
I think the future lies with platforms, solutions, services that make it much easier and cost effective. And that's where we are focused on. We're not focused like we are a video company. Yes, we do explainers. I don't even say that I do explainer videos. It doesn't matter. That's something, if a client needs it, they will ask me for it and we'll do it. Yeah. I'm never going to pitch it because it's lost in a sea of everybody else doing the same things. I'm going after solving their problem. And their problem is I want video, I want it cost effectively, and I want it tomorrow. Now there are platforms, DIY platforms, automated platforms that do work really well. And I think they will evolve as we go. This is part of the future. Mm-hmm. But there is also another future where you have a more high touch approach that has higher quality, better messaging, better branding, and it's not the automated thing that anybody can spit out in 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. So the companies that can streamline and scale video solutions, I think that's the future of video in the next 3 to 5 years. We're working on that and we're very excited about it. We're doing a lot of initiatives around micro content, engaging employees, sales pitches with video RFPs, like $1 million RFPs, and they have amazing results. Sometimes I don't even understand why, but they really work. So it's all about video storytelling at scale.
Yeah. And you don't see that changing anytime soon. You see it ramping up.
It takes a little while, so we have it at a good stage, but we're working on things that will show up in a year. And video is evolving so fast with different platforms that give you so many capabilities.
Yeah.
That next year will look very different. Like right now, we can do video testimonials like that.
Yeah.
And have a link, somebody clicks on it, they record it, it posts on the page automatically.
And it's done.
Before you had a whole workflow that cost thousands of dollars, now you can do it for 10 bucks.
Mm-hmm.
But you still charge the thousands, right? I'm teasing.
So these are things that we can use as loss leaders. So we might do them for free. For example, if you have like on our website, we have a a video, instead of a chatbot, we have a video chatbot. So you see a video and it interacts with you. And we offer this to clients for free because that's our loss leader to create a relationship. So technology enables us to give more video and give them access, and slowly they get more accustomed to video. And then we do the higher end stuff that has higher impact for them as well.
Yeah, it's just like sort of dipping the toe in and then incrementally increasing the temperature. So KP, it has been awesome to talk with you. We are almost running out of time. I want to ask you though, for our audience who's listening to you and interested about what you're doing and what you have coming up, where can they find you?
You know, the best way to reach me is my email. Can I give the email here? Or?
Yeah, go ahead.
If I have any questions about anything, I'm more than happy to help. It's Costa, K-O-S-T-A, at boardstudios.com. So that's the main business. And because we're evolving and innovating, we have all these side websites that we'll be integrating into Board Studios. So we don't have it centralized yet, but we have the Board Studios labs that will be opening soon. And you will see all the initiatives like micro content and platforms, investing in technology, developing our own platforms. We're super excited about that for the next year or two.
Awesome. Thank you. You were amazing. I learned something every time I listen to you. Appreciate it.
You're so kind. I appreciate it.
Thank you. And to our audience, thank you for joining us for another episode of the Mavens of Marketing. And we will see you back here next time.